Hello, everybody. Welcome to our live event, Hangout on Air. I am joined today with my special guest, Jackie Von Tobel. Hi, Jackie.
Hi, how are you, Kim?
And I'm good, Jackie, thanks. And Deb Barrett. Hi, Deb.
Hi.
So thank you all for taking time out of your busy day to join us for this live scheduled Hangout on Air. So I'd like to get right going and start off with having each of our guests tell us a little bit about who they are and how they got started in their own businesses and what they do. So Deb, if you could start.
Sure. I started in the window treatment business in the 70s, a long time ago, and actually came out of the apparel industry. And as my kids started to grow, I started my own business, left corporate buying job in the fashion industry and started working in the home area. And I've been doing window treatments as a designer and specifier since 1990. So again, 25 years. Through that, sort of kind of organically started doing some consulting and some speaking and doing some trend strategy things for manufacturers. So I wear a lot of different hats. But my first love and passion is definitely soft and window treatments.
Thanks, Deb. So before we switch over to Jackie, could you tell us something about yourself, Deb, that people probably don't know?
Probably. I own an bagger, Harley Davidson hog, and I ride it.
Awesome. Okay, Jackie, now could you tell us the same information about yourself?
Oh, sure. I went to design school and then promptly got married and had a bunch of kids, three kids, and really didn't do much with it until the late 80s when my kids were a little bit older and began my design career. I was a high-end, full-service interior designer for 20-some years, and I did what's called sort of conception to completion design. So we designed everything from, working with the the architects to plot out, placement of the homes on raw land, up to doing all of the build-outs, everything in the houses down to the toilet paper sometimes. And it was a great career. I got to learn how to do a lot of different things in it. But one of the things that, again, much like Deb, was sort of a passion for me was anything covered in fabric. And I had learned how to sew as a young child and sewed all through, my youth. And that led me to begin to write books on window treatments and soft furnishings. And when the economy took a turn for the worse here in Las Vegas, I had sort of a big decision to make on where I wanted my direction in my life to go. And for me, it was away from the big world of high-end interior design and to, a more focused niche for myself, which was really concentrating on soft furnishings and then art. That's it.
Great. Now, is there something about you that we may not know about?
Well, I think most people associate me with soft furnishings, but I also design products for all sorts of strange and weird applications. So I do what's called art licensing. So I design things like dishes and stationery and garden things like yard flags, just all kinds of weird stuff. Christmas decorations and that type of thing. I've been doing that for the last 3 years. So most of it doesn't have my name on it, so you wouldn't know it was mine, but it's out there.
Oh, great. That's neat. I did not know that. So can you both tell us, whichever one of you would like to start, a little bit about what is the Soft Design Lab?
Well, Soft Design Lab is a passion project that Deb and I have been thinking about for quite some time how we can most effectively impact the soft design furnishing industry and, our fellow designers. We both have been teaching for a long time. We have a similar, viewpoint on the industry and passion for anything made, with fabric. And so we really were just waiting for the right time to come up with this idea, and it just happens to be now. So the Soft Design Lab is an online hub or a base camp, if you will, for members of the soft design furnishings industry, whether they be designers, manufacturers, workrooms, vendors, to get together, to learn about soft furnishings, to further our industry, and to promote community and understanding between the different arms of our business. And we're hoping that, you know, we can really make a difference in our industry through it.
Great. So when you use the word soft, or the term rather, soft furnishings, what would you, how would you describe that term?
Well, for me, it's, you know, categories like window treatments, decorative pillows, some accent upholstery, obviously upholstered furniture, anything that has fabric on it, and that sort of, all those categories under that umbrella term is one of the reasons that Jackie and I sort of came together. I think that's where we found our common ground, because we're so, that's what we love. I'm a fabricolic, and Jackie, I know, loves soft furnishings, and that sort of was the jumping off start of the point of getting the conversation going for our collaboration. But Jackie, additions?
Well, I think that you know, the Webster's unabridged version would be that soft furnishings are anything that are made with or covered by fabric. And so if you really think about it, I think, you know, sometimes in our industry we tend to minimize that niche. And in reality, it's equal to or more than 50% of everything that is specified for any interior, whether it's commercial, hospitality, residential, whatever. You know, we're surrounded by fabrics and textiles in our business, and you know, I think that's one of the frustrations that I think both Deb and I have experienced over the years, is it does get tended to be minimized as a factor of design, which to me I don't really understand, because many times that was where I always would begin my designs, is with fabric selection.
Yeah, and you find a lot of people, I mean, I know over the years doing some of the stuff I do, people choose the paint color first, and then you can't find the perfect fabric, where it's much easier to start with your fabrics, like you said,
and
do your paint colors later. Yeah. So how did the two of you decide to partner up? I mean, how did this come about?
Over a glass of wine.
Or two.
On a cocktail napkin.
You know, like a red. But we were at Design Bloggers Conference, and as Jackie said, we've known each other for quite a while, and would run into each other or meet each other at events, and we said, oh, we need to do something together, and really didn't have a finger on what it was. And we were sitting down at Design Bloggers Conference and kind of mulling over some of the comments that were made in the seminars during that day, and we went, you know what, this is it, this is the time, let's work this out, let's figure out how to do it. So on the cab ride to the airport, we started hashing out our business plan, and fast and furious, 60 days later, here we are. It's all about, you know, bootstrap entrepreneurship, which is awesome in today's technology, that, you know, we probably couldn't have done that 5 years ago.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
So who are you hoping to reach with this venture that you've started?
Well, I think that, you know, what we want to try to do, and this was very important for us, is that we want to create a comprehensive destination. So we definitely, our first target would be designers, decorators, but also the do-it-yourself homeowner who's interested in it. And then what we want to do is try and pair those people with the manufacturers and also workrooms, so that we can create a dialogue that helps everybody. So that when you're looking for a product, you know, you're going to hear about it before you have to research it on your own. Or if you're looking for a workroom or things about specific things that are made in workrooms, you know, hopefully we would have some great information for you on there. And as designers, we're going to be offering up just a whole array of different tools in different formats that are really going to help you grow as a soft designer.
You know, one of the things that other industries have that we did, we really thought that there was an opportunity and a void in, is the fact that they have these kind of sort of think tanks and customer hubs and things. A lot of it's driven sometimes by manufacturers when you look at hard surfaces and what's happening in flooring and tile and things. But we don't have this, you know, group or customer hub. In fact, you know, if you think about it, where do the fabric manufacturers even show their wares? That, you know, you've got to be, you have to be proactive as the designer, decorator, whoever it is, to either, you know, search them out in a showroom or a design center, or you know, find out how to open accounts and all those kinds of things, which is kind of unusual. Other industries are, you know, holding trade shows and conferences and virtual conferences and things, and really putting themselves out there. So that's why one of the reasons we felt that it was important to be comprehensive, and because it's a win-win then for everybody.
Yeah, that's great. Just so that the public who's watching this knows, I've just been notified that we're having a little bit of technical difficulty and you're only seeing Jackie Von Tobel during our presentation.
Oh, boy.
You're not getting to see him. So, sorry about that, but we will continue.
No problem.
Deb doesn't mind. Yeah, I don't mind either, Deb. So.
Well, and actually, we've had all kinds of difficulty today. We did practice and we had it all nailed, but Deb actually has to leave early anyway, so...
we're good.
We won't even know that she's gone. We should
there you go.
See, the technology knew that.
And as Jackie said earlier, that's the benefit of having a collaborative of partnership.
Yes. Well, okay, it's amazing to me. I will say one thing, though, that and this really kind of goes back to how this came about. You know, as one person trying to affect change or trying to share knowledge, in a specific industry, it's really difficult, you know. But you put two or three minds together, it's absolutely amazing what you can achieve. And this is a great example of it. I mean, we've all known each other for quite a long time. And, you know, when we collaborate instead of compete, everybody benefits. And so that kind of, I think, is collaboration, I would say, would be the underlining or lying tone of the Soft Design Lab.
So where do you see, the next question I had for you is, where do you see the state of the soft design industry?
Well, I think that in a lot of ways we're sort of almost at, we're at a tipping point. One thing that we were seeing and that we was definitely validated for us at High Point last month was that manufacturers from other industries are recognizing the significance of soft goods and soft furnishings and coming into the realm and creating different distribution channels. So if you're talking about custom soft furnishings in the traditional distribution channel, which is the designer, decorator, upholsterer, window treatment workroom, whatever, our landscape is going to get crowded very quickly. And unless we know how to adapt to that and to differentiate from that, it's going to be a lost art in some cases, and science, because they're big enough and they have enough, you know, wherewithal to in some cases move, you know, the independent out of the marketplace, which is really, that's one of the other reasons that we went into that. We felt that through this hub and education and talking about how you can master this niche and really, you know, kick butt with it, excuse my French, is to prepare yourself for that adaptation. Jackie, thoughts?
Well, and to that point, especially seeing so many big mainstream companies, such as, for example, like Asuria Rugs going into bedding and pillows. You have Uttermost going into upholstered goods. We saw companies like Burton James doing signature private label collections for designers. It's a little bit scary at first, I think, because you think, well, these guys are going to take it over. They're going to, you know, mass produce us out of business. Well, the other thing that they're going to do, though, is they're going to drive the popularity back to soft furnishings. When you're seeing that, they're putting big bucks behind advertising those products and getting them to the forefront of the customer's mind. It directly benefits all of us as independent vendors and manufacturers and whatever you are, workroom. because they now sort of take that Pottery Barn-esque stigma off of those items, you know, where we've been seeing bare windows now for, what, the last 5 or 6 years in abundance. Now we're starting to see the popularity factor going back to it. So I think it's a double-edged sword. I think if we ignore what's happening, you know, we'll be in trouble. But for me, I really feel like we have an incredibly bright future ahead of us. I think soft goods are being featured by these vendors, which means that they see that the clients and customer base want those items. They see, you know, the benefit to selling them, which in turn can only basically benefit us and increase us, because we are a community that is selling custom product to a higher end, you know, for the most part clientele, or for somebody who wants something unique. And so as you get sort of cookie cutter product coming out into the mainstream, even though some of it is really great and looks really good, you can also then use that and bolster your offering by offering some of that product as well. So I really think that, you know, we're kind of, I hate to even say that we're, you know, coming down the hill of despair that we've been in for the last few years, but I see it as being very bright.
No, I totally agree, and I think it's just that we have to be strategic, because we've seen it in our own industry. We're seeing our major hardline manufacturers, like a Graber or a Hunter Douglas, moving into soft, you know, with the artisan drape for Graber, and, you know, who knows where Hunter will take it in all their wisdom, etc. So, I mean, I think there's huge opportunity. It's about being strategic, and we're hoping that you'll come to us to help you be strategic.
So with all these different avenues that you guys have just mentioned that are adding soft goods to their line, are we seeing an area where we're going to have a lot of different price points so that we can reach more clientele? So if you have a client who can't afford the true, you know, custom to the T, are we going to be seeing products that they can then afford and still get that custom feel?
I think absolutely, and that's another reason why we as independent vendors, designers, need to keep in touch with what's going on with these big manufacturers, is because we then can sell that product as well. So you're not every room is going to be, you know, a huge custom installation. But what we've seen, you know, over the past few years is this loss of market share that we're giving away, you know, these sales to either ready-made product, or now, you know, these other manufacturers are getting on the bandwagon with semi-custom products. So you need to either take advantage of that, or, you know, you're going to be left by the wayside. So there's still plenty of room for custom product, but why not jump in and utilize some of those vendors for the products that they're offering? So there's a huge range of price difference. The one thing that Deb and I did see at market, though, that is really encouraging is that there also are some really great vendors that will help you with turnaround times and stuff for your clients that have a great offering, beautiful fabrics, and they're quick ship product, but they're well made. They have inner lining in them, and you can get custom sizes and custom widths and beautiful fabrics, and you can do COM. Companies like Eastern Accents, for example, ramping up their you know, custom workroom and their manufacturing. So, you know, I think that sometimes we in our industry shy away from going towards wholesale manufacturers that sell to retail because we don't want to play in that area. But I think now it's going to take a mix of all these different things to really be successful as a soft furnishings retailer. Deb?
Deb actually has left.
Okay. Jackie. She's left the building.
Unfortunately. So one of the questions I'm getting asked by some of the viewers is, are you going to have a list of some of these sources accessible to them through your website somehow, or your newsletter, or how are you going to do that?
We have many different channels, and of course we're just getting up to speed, but here's some of them. So we're going to have a blog, which we've only got a couple posts up there so far, but we'll be doing twice weekly blog posts. We'll have regular features. One of those, of course, will be introducing new vendors, manufacturers. We'll be doing new product offerings that are coming onto the market. You know, the nice thing, especially partnering with Deb, her status within the industry as being, you know, sort of a leader as far as press goes in our industry. She gets the news first. And so we're going to put that out, you know, in Deb Barrett time. And we want to get it to you. We want to get it out to you quickly. So that's going to be really kind of a constant news feed, whether it's through our Facebook page, whether it's on the blog post. It'll eventually wind its way up into, you know, the actual website, which, by the way, is www.softlab.com. And we will have a press page for different press releases as they come out live. So you hopefully will be able to get there up-to-minute, most current information and product releases and that types of things. We'll also be doing what we're terming our Take 10 event, which is every Friday. I believe the first and third Friday of the month are email blasts. That it's basically 10 things or 10 minutes of time just with really great sort of concentrated facts and issues, always be different subject matter. The first one that we did, which is now up on the website, if you can't get it live, then you can see it on the website, was a style quiz. And I think, Kim, you took it. What did you think of it?
I thought it was very good. And I got the, what was it, the boho chic.
Right. So it's a little style quiz to test your soft identity. And so then this week, tomorrow actually, 1 o'clock Eastern time, will be our first live Take 10. And so it should be anywhere around 10 minutes. It's a webinar. You can sign up for it on either our Facebook page or on the website. And that will be a first look at High Point Market. It'll be the soft furnishing trends that Deb and I found at High Point. So every Friday, it's just a 10-minute little pit stop for you. If you want to get it live, or you can read them at any time on the website, but it's just a little tidbit of information. And then we're also going to be doing many, many webinars. We've got, you know, between Deb and I, the amount of knowledge that we realize that we have, you know, stored either up here or on the computer is kind of staggering. So just getting it on the website, you know, just after years of teaching seminars and traveling and going to events and things like that. So we've got lots of ebooks planned. Some will be free, some will be for purchase. We want to give away as much information as we possibly can.
I have another question here, if you don't mind, because I think we're getting into a different direction.
Sure.
How do you see this new way of design affecting the wholesale workroom?
Well, again, I think that for the wholesale workroom, there's still that client. And I think for me, I see the popularity of window treatments coming back as a win-win. As you know, when you're in the design business, a lot of times the last thing people want is something somebody else can get,
right,
even if it is cheaper. You know, if you and let me tell you that a lot of the ready-mades that we have seen are at least the ones that are quality that would compete with something that was made in a quality workroom are going to be at least equal to or greater than the cost of what you're producing, because they have shipping costs, they have, you know, other costs that we don't have. They've got to roll over their advertising and their overhead and all of that into their price point. And so they're not inexpensive at all. So in my mind, you know, I'm no fortune teller, but I think anything that is going to put soft furnishings out there in the face of the public and make it a priority is a win for us. Our challenge isn't going to be whether the business is going to be there. I feel that it's going to be, do we have the personnel to take care of that business? Because, you know, we've had that sort of exodus out of our profession in the last few years due to, you know, lack of training and also, you know, the lack of just the economy. So I think that's a bigger issue, but I look at it as being bright. I'm going for a bright, bright, bright future.
I always like the positive side of the world myself.
I would tell you, if I thought it was going to be bad, I would tell you.
And I mean, I like you had mentioned, you know, the window treatments seem to be getting more popular. It's really great to see a lot of these magazines now featuring rooms done with window treatments.
Isn't it amazing?
Yeah, I mean, for a few years, you weren't seeing that anywhere.
No, and I'll tell you what else, which is front and center, too, the trends, and this goes to part of our take 10 that we're going to go over tomorrow, but we saw countless items of upholstered furniture, case goods, full dressers upholstered and with nail heads, tables, all kinds of things. So when these kind of trends take off, if you think about it from your perspective as an upholsterer, you might be getting a whole lot of, you know, people's old furniture, and you're going to have to upholster that and, you know, be ready with those nail heads, because that's a new service that you can offer. People were using tons of trim in interesting ways, lots of upholstered screens. It's like fabric is king right now.
Wow. So were they like, you know, wholesale vendors using those, or were they the fabric companies? It was the vendors, huh?
Both. Across the board, the bedding vendors are trying to, I mean, everything was covered in fabric. Lighting was covered in fabric.
Wow.
I never thought I'd ever see that day. Fabric and nail heads.
I guess I better get some dressers in practice.
I'm telling you, and it's beautiful. It was absolutely just, you know, gorgeous. So we'll see how long that trend lasts, but, you know, it's, I think it's to our benefit.
I know. I love seeing the new trends that go in and out. It's always fun to see what really takes hold.
Yeah.
So before we end today, do you have any, like, tips or secret source that you'd love to part with at this moment?
Oh, my goodness. Do you want a design source or a product source? All right, I'll show you. I actually showed Kim this the other day. This is one of my favorite sources for alternative hardware embellishment. It's called Pearlworks, PEARLWORKS.com. They're out of San Diego, California, and I'm going to probably rip my earphones out of my ear doing this. Whoops. Sorry. I have to put myself back together. Or maybe not. Boy, that was a smooth transition, wasn't it? Okay, so this
life
is a company that sells resin onlays, and they're really made for woodworkers. But the great thing about these is that they sell these in, this one comes in, I think, 10 different sizes, like from huge to mini. And so if I'm doing, you know, a very large treatment, but then I need smaller pieces, I can order in different sizes. It's just flat on the back, but they, you can have your workroom just drill right into it, or you can drill brackets onto the back of it. This is a piece that I've used before that it's one of my favorites. But the great thing about this stuff, too, and let's see if I can show you this way, is that it bends. It's made out of this formable resin. So if you're doing something curved or round or whatever, I mean, you really can go to town with this stuff. And you can paint it, gild it, do whatever you want to it. So that's a source that I've always used. And my second source would be your local hardware store. I grew up in a hardware store. And for me, I've always found great stuff there. I love to go in and just try and figure out, you know, what can I make out of that? How can I make that unique and individual?
Yeah, I'm the same way. I go in the hardware store and just have to, like, stare at all the shelves and see, okay, what can I do with that? I'm the same way at flea markets, too. It's like I love repurposing things. Yeah.
Oh, no, absolutely.
So, okay, it looks like we don't have any more questions. Do you have anything else you'd like to share with us today, Jackie? I mean, I think we've done most stuff.
Sure. I would just encourage people, you know, this, I just want to put, and Deb and I both want to emphasize that, this really is a labor of passion for the two of us. We have a lot of other stuff going on, and but this really is going to sort of be our priority. And but it's not necessarily a money-making proposition. We really want people to have a place to go to get information, to learn, to create a community, and to help each other open up a dialogue between manufacturers and vendors and you know, designers and workrooms, so that we can all further our industry, because that's the only way that any of us really are going to prosper, is if we can work, you know, together and sort of envelop some of the success that mainstream design community is garnering right now. And so we need to sort of take some of those aspects and put them together, and that's really what we're trying to do. So you're not going to get a hard sales pitch if you come to the website. All we want to do is use for you to go there, sign up for the email, and we will start sending you valuable information. It's not going to be buy this, buy that, whatever. We want to give you good stuff for free.
I actually do have a couple more questions that came
sure.
in. Somebody said they tried the pearlworks.com and it's showing something else. Are they spelling it wrong? They've got pearlworks.com.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I haven't checked in a little while. I hope they're not gone.
Okay.
I would try them like in the San Diego. It was always pearlworks.com.
Okay, so just maybe
probably
do a search.
It's been like 3 months since I, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Pearlworks.
And the other thing somebody is asking is the manufacturers you're talking about with these different products, do you have to have like minimum orders, or are they something that, you know, somebody can order a small quantity from, or do you have to be a larger designer?
Right. Well, the beauty of the recession, if there is anything that came out of it, is the minimum order, it really is no longer. You can buy onesies and twosies now from pretty much... I won't say everybody, the larger stocking dealers that are selling upholstered goods and case goods, you know, you'll need a minimum. But for these companies, for example, you know, you might have like a $200 buy-in, like for Eastern Accents, I think, has a buy-in. I'm not sure what it is, but it's, I mean, you know, one comforter from them is $400. So you're not going to have a problem, you know, buying in. There's really no barriers to entry anymore. There used to be. They didn't want individual people now, and what they found is that's what's kept them alive through the bad times, and so I'm not sure that it'll ever go back to the way it was. But no, and we, in view of that question too, we'll put that on whatever information that we post on the website. I think that's a good point to include that information so people know what the minimum order is, if there is one, and all of that, mm-hmm. So we'll include that.
Okay, so somebody did type in that it's actually pearlworksinc.com.
Ah, excellent.
So, there we go.
Excellent.
And when you and I had spoke the other day, Jackie, you had mentioned something about King Architectural.
Oh, King Architectural Metals is another one. And if anybody has ever read my books, you'll know that I love gate hardware. Is one of the things that just, I love it. Just big, you know, hinges and mm-hmm. handles and things. And they are a company that has, hold on 1 second, I'm going to grab this book. This one is so new that I haven't even taken it out of the cover yet. But you can see how big this thing is. This is a treasure trove of design doodads. And they sell all of the pieces and parts that, let's say, your guy that's making your iron stair rails puts together. And so they're beautiful acanthus sleeves. And the same thing, like this filigree piece, but it'll be in metal. And they'll drill brackets on the back of it. You just have to tell them what you need, or you can take it to your local welder, and they can put it together for you. But, you know, the pieces in there will blow your mind, because you'll get something like this for, like, $3. You know, on Pearlworks, I think this is maybe like $13. I mean, it's ridiculously inexpensive stuff. And you do have to finish it, but it's very easy. And, you know, to me, those are the kind of things that set you apart as a designer, is when you can offer custom abilities that add to your designs. So, and let me make sure I've got their website for you here. This is kingmetals.com. King, like King Metals, metals.com. And they're out of LA.
That's a great source. I know, because it, like you had mentioned, you know, making it custom. I mean, I remember mm-hmm. a friend of mine through a local designer I think she was a workroom. And she was doing something for a person that had horses. And so mm-hmm. she actually used some of like the metal off horse bridles and things in her.
Oh, wow.
And it was great, because it did give it that special extra mm-hmm. detail, you know?
Well, when you can offer that type of customization to your client, that's always going to set you above any sort of ready-made and any kind of, even if it's a, you know, semi-custom product, they can't offer that personalization. And the world that we are living in today, it's all about customization and personalization. The more personal you can make it, you know, the more beneficial you are to your clients.
You are so right. Yeah. So I want to thank you, Jackie, for giving us all this information. It's too bad that Deb had to leave shortly, short into the topic, but she had something come up today. But I appreciate everybody taking the time out of their schedules to find out more about what Jackie and Deb are doing. And I hope you'll go check out their Soft Design Lab website and follow them and take some advice from their Take 10. So everybody have a great day. And again, thanks.
You know, I've got one more point that I forgot to mention too, is that, sure, you know, we're really looking for feedback. You know, we want it, like I said, we want to create a dialogue and create a community. So if you have any thoughts or whatever you want to, just email us something you would like to see that you think is lacking in the industry, something that you would like to see on a website like this. As we go forward, as we're posting things, like the comment about what the buy-in is, you know, if there are things like that that would be helpful to you, I would love, and Deb would love to hear those comments. So please feel free to email us and just, you know, give us a piece of your mind. And we'd really appreciate it. And thank you so much, Kim, for having us and your patience. And sorry Deb had to leave, but she just got in off a plane last night at midnight and had a grandchild emergency. So.
All right. Well, thanks again, Jackie, and I look forward to finding out more about your Take 10s and checking out your website a little bit deeper.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming.
Bye, everybody. Have a good day.
Bye.